So we're going to read out of John chapter 6. We're going to be covering verses 15 through 40. I'm reading out of the King James Version, John chapter 6, verse 15. Therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he departed again to the mountain by himself alone. Now, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into the boat, and went over the sea toward Capernaum. And it was already dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. Then the sea arose because a great wind was blowing. So when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near the boat, and they were afraid. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. On the following day, when the people who were standing on the other side of the sea saw that there was no other boat there except that one which his disciples had entered, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but his disciples had gone away alone. However, other boats came from Tiberias near the place where they ate bread after the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got into boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. Verse 25, that's a good thing, seeking Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them and said, "Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but by the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him." Then they said to him, "What shall we do that we may work the works of God?" Jesus answered and said to them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent." Therefore they said to him, "What sign will you perform then, that we may see it and believe you? What work will you do? Our fathers ate the manna in the desert, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives his life to the world." Then they said to him, "Lord, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said this to you, that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." That's the word of the Lord. So have a seat. We're in John chapter 6. As I said, Jesus, the bread of life, is the message. Jesus, the bread of life. Last week, Jesus fed 5,000 people. And with women, or 5,000 men, with women and children, with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. He met their immediate need by performing a miracle, but he also taught them about the kingdom of God. But instead of believing and accepting him as the long-awaited Messiah, as the scriptures said that they would be, they wanted to make him the physical Messiah that they wanted him to be. Jesus' primary concern for humanity is not their stomach, but their soul. He's not their supermarket, he's their savior. So let us see what the true meaning of Jesus as our bread of life means. We have 4 points here. I know many of you take notes, so I have 4 points. The first one is the disciples need Jesus, verse 15 to 21. Point 2 is the people seek Jesus, verse 22 to 25. Point 3, the people seek bread from Jesus, verse 26 through 34. And the fourth point is the people need Jesus, the bread of life. So point 1 is the disciples need Jesus. Point 2, the people seek Jesus. Point 3, the people seek bread from Jesus. And point 4, the people need Jesus, the bread of life. And it says here at the beginning, I find this fascinating. It says in verse 15 that they wanted to take him by force and make him king. I don't know how you take God by force, you know. But isn't that so like man trying to tell God what he should do? Or trying to have God get on board with them. No one tells what God what to do. I'm surprised that Jesus didn't use his miracle powers here to do something to these people, but he didn't, because he loved them and he had a higher purpose. Not proving the point, his higher purpose was to go to the cross. You see, Jesus didn't come to seek popularity and be a puppet king. They thought their Messiah would overturn Rome and give them freedom. But Jesus would come to overthrow sin and give them true freedom as they put their life in Jesus. And at a later date, he would come back and he would be that conquering king. But it wasn't right then. See, Jesus sought people, not position. He sought people, not popularity. You know, that's what man does. Man seeks position. Man seeks popularity. Jesus seeks the people. Jesus loves the people. I find it humorous. One minute they say he's a prophet, and then they want to force him to be king. It's just a reminder of how fickle people can be. You know, they can say one thing, and then, you know, later they say something else. But time will tell what they really believe or who they are. And Jesus would see this again. He's going to hear from people, blessed are you, he who comes in the name of the Lord. And later on, from many of the same people, he would hear, crucify him, crucify him. Reminds me of Lori and I had a Bible study, our first Bible study years ago. It was actually, you know, a fun time. And we had this meeting with all the other Bible study leaders and the worship leaders and the hosts and a pastor. And they would go around and say different things. And the guy that we had the Bible study, he goes, yeah, I wasn't a pastor then. He goes, yeah, when Marty teaches, it's just like Jesus. I just sit here and listen to his word. I'm like, shut up. You know? First of all, they're going to think I paid you. Second of all, it's not true. Third, I don't want to be struck by lightning. But what's funny about this is later on, study was going great. But the host, they had a couple kids, and one was just a little rambunctious. So we took them out to dinner and just said, we know we have a few complaints from quite a few parents. We just need to work through these things. I get a phone call the next day. He goes, you insulted us? You are not having a home study at our house anymore. We're done. I'm like, let's talk about it. And he just wouldn't. So one day I'm Jesus. The next day is, you can't even come to my house, and you can't bring your friends over with me. I'm like, okay. But that's how people are. You know, you'll get to know people as time goes on. What, you know, people that say they're on your side and on board and love you and all that. But you know what? Jesus knew that. Jesus had thick skin. That's what I love about Jesus. It didn't faze him at all. But it says he departed again to the mountains by himself alone. Now, this story is also in Matthew 14 and Mark 6. And what I love about it is, and I hope all of us know, that often there are stories in the Bible that are maybe in two or three or even other two or three different places in the Bible. And when we look at those other stories, we fill in some of the things that aren't in that story and we can glean more from it. Well, in these other two Gospels, it says Jesus made his disciples get into the boat to go the other side, and he sent the multitudes away so he could go up on the mountain to pray. You don't quite get that here, but that's what happened. And Jesus, it would say about him in Luke 5:16, so he himself often withdrew into the wilderness and prayed. I like that. He often went into the wilderness and prayed. That's one of the reasons we had the Tuesday prayer meeting. We want to follow Jesus' example. If he needed to pray all the time, we need to pray. We need God's help. We need to hear from the Lord. So, I would encourage anybody to come out to our Tuesday night prayer meeting. I do a little bit of teaching in addition to worship, and then we have a time of prayer. So we're going through the Lord's Prayer. When we're done with that, we're going to go through the armor of God. We're going to do teachings throughout the Bible on prayer, Old Testament, New Testament, to get more of a foundation on prayer. But when I see this, that he made his disciples get into the boat and sent the multitudes away, and he went on the mountain, I can't help but think of what he taught us right before he taught us the Lord's Prayer. He said, but you, when you pray, go into your room and shut your door and pray to your Father who's in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. So when you go into your room and you shut the door, you lock out all the distractions, and it's just you and the Father. Well, Jesus was shutting out all of these other people, and he was going on the mountain, so it was just him and his Father. He models that principle for us. And what's really cool about that verse is it goes on to say, and the Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Meaning there's going to be a blessing on your life when you take time to be with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you're on your knees just looking to him and praying to him. God is going to bless you. Which begs the question, do you intentionally get away to pray by yourself? I'm not looking for a show of hands. They say that's one of the most embarrassing questions as they ask anybody, even pastors, hey, how's your prayer life? Everyone's like, well, you know, that's just a tough thing. But do you intentionally get away to pray by yourself? J. Oswald Sanders said, to be much alone with God is the secret of knowing him and of influence with him. Think about that. To be much alone with God is the secret of knowing him and of influence with him. And I was thinking about this. One of the primary things that keeps us from spending time with the Lord is busyness. And I saw this great quote on busyness from C.H. Spurgeon. Sometimes we think we are too busy to pray. That is a great mistake, for praying is a saving of time. Did you know that? You think you don't have enough time to pray. When you pray, you actually save time. Because God honors that. God blesses you. Often he gives you wisdom to make a decision that you didn't think about. Often he's moving pieces around to where you're going to go to work it out for you because you prayed. God is a saver of time. And I heard this great quote. Make time to pray. The great freight and passenger trains are never too busy to stop for fuel. No matter how congested the yards may be, no matter how crowded the schedules are, no matter how many things demand the attention of the trainmen, those trains always stop for fuel. I thought that, you know, it's like we're going down the track of life and we're going to run out of fuel if we don't pull over and spend time with the Lord, is what he's saying. And as one of my friends, Pastor Rick, who I just saw, he's here, he used to say, Marty, you know what the acronym for busy is? And I go, no, what's that? Being under Satan's yoke. Think about that. Busyness is a lot. Sometimes we get so busy, even thinking we're doing good things, but it's like a yoke that we're so busy we don't take time for the Lord. And then here in verse 16 through 19, it talks about the disciples getting in the boat and going to the other side, and they're on the sea. And in verse 19, it says, when they had rowed 3 or 4 miles. And like I said, the other gospels say that Jesus saw them straining at rowing. Isn't that interesting? He's like, oh, look at those guys. This is so funny. This dude is so great, you know? And they're like, Jesus, where are you? He just went, not yet, not yet. It says, and then he came to them walking on water. And the other gospels say they were afraid and cried out, it's a ghost. I thought, how could they say it? Well, I started thinking about that. It's okay. It's the middle of the night. It's dark. They're tired. And nobody walks on water. So it's totally unexpected. I could see them freaking out. Is it a ghost? And then he gets closer. And then Jesus gets into the boat. By the way, if you ever think you saw a ghost or something freaky or something supernatural, that's the best thing you can do is cry out to Jesus. Because once Jesus gets in there, it's a whole different ball game. But he says these often quoted words that you see throughout the Bible. It is not I, do not be afraid. That is such a comfort. It is not I, do not be afraid. What did I say? It is I, do not be afraid. Thank you. That's what I love about this congregation. They hold you accountable. They don't let you just keep on going. Love you guys. Obviously, I need your prayers. I need your accountability. It is he, do not be afraid. But Jesus said, it is I, do not be afraid. Because we see this concept throughout the scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament. One of my favorite verses is Joshua 1:9. It's a tremendous verse of courage and encouragement. It says, have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage? Do not be afraid nor be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. When God called us out, that's what he told me. Marty, it doesn't matter where you go. Wherever you go, I am with you. If your heart is right, you're wanting to do God's work for his kingdom, go. I'm going to be there. Isaiah 41:10 says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Yes, I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I think that's where that old expression came from. Never fear, I am here. And I saw it on some cartoon, but no, I think Jesus is the owner of that one. Do you know God is with you?
Yes.
If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, God is with you.
Yes.
You know, he says he'd be with all as always to the end of the age. And then in verse 21, I love how it says, then they willingly received him into the boat. They willingly received him. And immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. I thought about this. When you willingly receive Jesus into your boat or your life, so to speak, you immediately have his presence. And you have a guarantee that you will make it to the other side. When you willingly invite Jesus into your life, you are going to make it to the other side. Also, when you willingly invite Jesus into your situation or problems, he immediately starts to help. Kind of like I was just joking about Jesus just going like, I'm just sitting here rowing. Not yet, not yet. He's kind of like that. Like, you have problems. He's like, I'm here to help. I'm just waiting. You're going to call on me? You're going to do this on your own? When you call up to Jesus, he's like, okay. Because here's one of the key principles, one of my favorite verses in all the Bible. God resists the proud and gives grace to the humble. See, it doesn't say he doesn't help the proud. It says he resists him. It's almost like he just puts his hand out and says, you're not going anywhere. But when you humble yourself, we have grace. It's almost like once you humble yourself, you cry out to God, like, how can I help you? I've been waiting. That's how God is. That's how great God is. And notice he first calmed their hearts by saying, it is I, do not be afraid. Did I get that right?
Yes.
It is I. First he calmed their hearts, then he calmed the storms. And that's how often God does. We want him to fix our problems right away when we're going through the rough seas of life. But you know what? Jesus wants to calm the storm inside us, and then we can address the storm outside us. Because when you take care of the storm inside of you, you can weather the storms outside you. You following me? When we truly give our heart to Jesus and trust and confide in him, and he just starts doing work, and all of a sudden you just have a peace about, okay, he's in control. He's got this. That's the way the Lord is. You know, this was the fifth of the seven miracles that are documented here in the Gospels. He turned the water into wine. He healed a nobleman's son. He heals a lame man at the pool of Bethesda. He fed 5,000 men. Here he walks on water. He's also going to heal a blind man from birth, and he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead. So Jesus, and as we've been quoting this quite a few times in the last chapter of the Bible, where it talks about, or not Bible, the last chapter in John, where one of the reasons that John recorded all these miracles is that they would believe. Well, that's what Jesus was wanting them to believe, with the feeding of the 5,000 and everything else. But we're going to see that he's going to set up a major teaching moment for the rest of chapter 6. Even what we're reading today and what we're going to read next week is all out of this feeding on the 5,000 and how Jesus was setting the tone for a great teaching. And we're going to have part of it right here. And that leads us to point 2, the people seek Jesus in verse 22 through 25. And it talks about how they just see him, you know, he's on the other side of the ocean. He gets into a boat. He's not with them. And all of a sudden they're on the other side. And then he's in the boat. And he's like, well, how's this? What's going on? Is this a miracle? They perceive that somehow he miraculously got over there. I don't know if right when they got the boat, the disciples said, hey, by the way, we just saw him walk on water, you know. And they're like, wow. But then verse 23 says, however, other boats came from Tiberias. And then it almost sounds like they're thinking, well, you know, maybe he switched boats or something, you know. But I thought about, however, that's kind of a word that you will hear when someone tries to explain away a miracle of Jesus. You know, a doctor comes in and all of a sudden you just see your loved ones healed and you're giving glory to God. However, this is not a common occurrence. It's just, they give you some medical terms and you're like, what? No, it was a miracle. Lori and I were watching a movie the other day about I think it was called Breakthrough, about some boy who fell through the ice, and he was underwater for like 20 minutes or some crazy time. And to make a long story short, God starts bringing him back slowly, and there's one scene where the pastor and the mom each have his hand, and they're asking the questions, and he just squeezed my hand, and he would just squeeze it. He went and got the doctor, and he didn't squeeze it for the doctors. It's like, well, however, this stuff happens all the time. It's rigor mortis or something. I have some weird, I don't know. That's why I'm not a doctor. But he said something. He did say something. Okay, so we're going to move on here to the next point. Come on, bring it back. Okay. So verse 24, it says, when the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they also got in the boats and came to Capernaum seeking Jesus. Does that sound like a good thing that they were seeking Jesus? That sounds like a great thing. However, why were they seeking Jesus? Seeking Jesus is a great thing, but why? Did they have the right motive? I love what it says in Jeremiah 29. Everyone knows Jeremiah 29:11. No great promise. You know, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not to give. How's that go again? Anybody want to finish it for me?
Thoughts of peace, not
of
evil,
to
give you a future
and hope. Why don't you come up here and preach this for me? See, that's why we need another word. But then it goes on in 12 and 13 to say, then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. You will find God when you search for him with all your heart. Many people search him from a distance, like on their terms. I love that how, and for those of you that were with us a couple of months ago in John chapter 4, Jesus said this, 4:23, but the hour is coming and now is when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. So were these people calling upon his name, praying to him, searching him with all their heart and spirit and truth? We're going to find out in a minute. I remember years ago, I was on a construction job in Orange County. It was the Grand Californian, you know, that big old hotel next to Disneyland. I got to work on that project. It was a great project. And at the very end, it was just me and the biggest boss, big honcho, and then another guy. It's like three of us. We're just wrapping everything up. And I thought, okay, this is my time to give them the gospel. So I don't know why I did that, but anyways, so I finally get an opportunity to share it with him. And he goes, I already tried the Lord. What do you mean, tried the Lord? He goes, yeah, I had a girl, you know, she's a Christian, so I tried the Lord. I tried that stuff. Went back and forth, bottom line, didn't get very far, but I thought about that. You don't try the Lord, you know, like you try a new product or something in the supermarket, you know. You don't try the Lord. You either believe who he said he is and you fully commit to him and follow him, or you don't. It's like there's none of this, oh, I tried the Lord. Well, I knew he didn't try the Lord because you don't try. You stay and you never go back. Yep. When you've really experienced the Lord, you just can't go back.
Right.
And many people claim to be seekers of God or spiritual, but you bring up Jesus, they don't want to hear it. You know, that's the dividing line. It's not God. It's not spiritual things. It's Jesus. Because Jesus, as we talked about, is God in the flesh. And he is the one that brings salvation to our souls. But Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. So this next point, the people seek bread from Jesus. And this is exactly what we're talking about. Look at verse 26. Most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Mm-hmm. Wow. That really shows where their heart was. They weren't seeking him for spiritual reasons, but natural reasons. And you know what? Jesus knows the heart. You know, in John chapter 2, when we finished chapter 2, Jesus said this in John 2:23. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover during the feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs he did. Sounds good. Next verse. But Jesus did not commit himself to them because he knew all men. And had no need that anyone should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. God knows what's right in our heart. You know what? And I love the word of God because I quoted that passage, Hebrews 4:12. The Bible is, you know, the word of God, and Jesus is called the word of God. This is what it says in Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart, or the hidden motives of the heart. And then it goes on to say this, and there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Often when we read the Bible, it just like calls us out like, oh man. But Jesus knows everything about us. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good, for goodness sake. Man, that's like Santa Claus. Wrong guy. But Jesus knew their hearts and he knew their motives. And he still does the same with us. And you know what? He still loves us. Isn't that crazy? That's what's so good about it. But he tells them in verse 27 and 28, do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life. Some people think because he says, do not labor, that he was talking about works, like you've got to earn your way, your salvation. And by the next question in the next verse, when they say, what shall we do? You know, that's kind of what man's answer is. He wasn't talking about good works. Ephesians 2:8 says, for by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast. See, if it's of works, if it's what we do, we're going to brag about. That's human nature. But when you realize it's got nothing to do with you, it's all to do with him and what he did, what can you boast about? It's like, you can't. But he says, but the food which endures to everlasting life. What he's saying in this passage here is, don't waste your passion and energy on things of the flesh and the world, which won't truly satisfy and won't get you to heaven. See, Jesus is giving gospel truth because he loves him and because he loves us, because we're reading this. This is for all people to read. And here's a question. Are you wasting time on things of the flesh and or of the world that don't feed your spirit, but can actually dull your senses to the things of the Lord? We can labor at work. We can labor at hobbies. We can labor at entertainment. We can labor at many things and cause God to lose his importance in our life. Here's something to think about. God doesn't want to be in your rearview mirror. He wants to be in your windshield. Think about that. He doesn't want you just in an afterthought where he's like this big and, you know, he wants to be in front of you. He wants you to be looking to him. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but the food which endures for everlasting life. I think a deeper meaning of this passage is what our sister Lorena read earlier. Why do you spend, in Isaiah 55:2, why do you spend money for what is not bread and your wages for things that don't satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me, hear and your soul shall live and I will make an everlasting covenant with you. Twice he uses the word soul. Jesus is concerned about our soul. They were concerned, like I said, about their stomach. We need to not be like the old country song, looking for love in all the wrong places. There's only one place, and that's in Jesus. But we can get distracted by laboring after so many other things that are going to pull us away from the Lord and aren't going to satisfy. Isaiah 45, 22 says, did I just spit? Did you guys see it up close? She's asking me, why are you saying this when we're on a video? I thought it's a good question. Anyways, God says in Isaiah 45, 22, look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. There is no other. There's only one. And then he says, which the Son of Man will give you. Isn't that a great promise? Eternal life is a free gift God offers to give us. We just need to receive it. He's always putting it out there. We just need to receive it. And then verse 28, like I said, what shall we do? That's what religion is. What will we do? What can I do to earn God's acceptance? What do I have to do? And I love how it says in 2 Timothy 1:9, God has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. See, God called us with a purpose. He didn't just save us to take us to heaven. He called us with a purpose. That's why we're still here. God's called for us to do a work. But it's not a works to earn God's approval. It's a works that we do because we have his approval, and we want our works to be a part of bringing people closer to him, bringing people into his kingdom. And far too many people put an emphasis on their works, what they do, trying to justify why God should accept them. But notice what Jesus says in verse 29. This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he sent. He's talking about himself. It's not about man's works. It's about what God has done, the work of Jesus. See, God did the work. He sent Jesus to live the perfect life, to die for man's sins on the cross, and rise again from the dead. Our only work is to believe and then follow Jesus. That's all we got to do. We got to believe him and we got to follow him. And then verse 30, it says, this is them speaking, and like I said, they're kind of showing their heart. What sign will you perform to us? Will you perform then that we may see it and believe you? I'm like, how about feeding 5,000 people and their families? How about walking on the water? I mean, you know, what signs do you need to see? And then they bring up this next point in verse 31. Our fathers ate manna in the desert. And he's talking about in the Old Testament where the children of Israel, God would actually bring manna every single day. It was kind of a little substance of dough. Many people think it was like a biscuit with honey on it or something. And every day they would have them and they would be able to collect. And they also would get quail and different things and water. And he's basically saying, hey, God, through Moses, gave us meals all the time. Kind of like suggesting that to Jesus. They were wanting a Jesus happy meal every day. And Jesus says, the only way you're going to get happy is if you eat of the bread of life, me, and get your soul saved. He goes, I didn't come here to do that. Their focus was on physical food, not spiritual things. But then you can see they're still kind of thinking, but they're saying, Lord, give us this bread always. Almost the same words as what the woman at the well said. When she was thinking, okay, living water, like I can get this and not come back. And so she says, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst nor come here to draw. Big difference between her and them. She believed and was used to bring revival to her city. That's what God wants us to do. He wants us to receive it, believe it, and bring revival to where we're at. He wants us to affect our circle of influence, as we talked about many times before, where you guys work, where you guys live, your family, and those types of things. And that really leads us to the last point, number four, that people need Jesus, the bread of life. Look in verse 35. I just love this. I am the bread of life. This is one of the seven I am statements that Jesus made. In the book of John. And all these I am statements are tremendous metaphors which express his saving relationship toward the world. And I'm just going to read them real quick and just make a quick mention on them. First of all, he says, I am the light of the world in John 8, 12. He says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. I know when I got saved and I saw that verse, I was like, that's it. So I felt like the light had gone on. All of a sudden he opened my eyes, the scales were pulled away, and I started seeing things through a whole different lens. And that's what he does. He pulls you out of darkness and into his marvelous light. Next is, I am the door of the sheep in John chapter 10, verses 9. He says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. He says, I am the door. I'm not one of many doors. This isn't like those game shows where you have all these doors. There's only one door, and that leads to eternal life, and that's Jesus. But then he says, not only will he be saved, but he will go in and out and find pasture. And that's one of the points I think Jesus is making even in this story. It's not just about eternity. It's about your life here. He wants you to go in and out and have pasture. He wants to feed you. He wants you to have relaxation. He wants to work with you and be with you on a daily basis. Then he says, I am the good shepherd in John 10, 11, and 14. And he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. That's exactly what it sounds like. It's talking about what Jesus did on the cross. I am the good shepherd, but I laid my life down for you, for the sheep. You know, and as a good shepherd, a really good shepherd, a true shepherd would fight out the wolves even till their death, because those wool or those sheep were there, where it's his ownership. So he would fight against the wolves. That's what Jesus was saying. But then it also goes on to say, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. Think about that. I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. And earlier I said that my sheep hear my voice and know me, and I know them. There's a relationship with God. God doesn't want to just save you and just make your life a little better. He wants to have a personal relationship on a daily basis. That's what he's talking about. Then he says, I am the resurrection and the life. That's in John 11, 25, when Lazarus is raised from the dead. This is a beautiful promise where he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. What that means is when we get into eternity, we are going to have a glorified body. You know? I was talking to somebody about just our, when we get older, you know, our bones and ache and that stuff. Me and my wife joke about this all the time. But when you get to heaven, you're going to get a glorified body, and there's no pain, there's no suffering, there's no death, there's no crying. It is all good. Guys, that is an awesome promise. I cannot wait for that. And then he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except by me. I am the way. I'm not one of many ways. I am the truth. There's no others. And I am the life. And no one comes to the Father except by me. Now, we understand that for salvation. No one comes to the Father except by me. But it tells us in Ephesians chapter 2 that we have access to the Father through Christ. We have access in our prayer life to the Father, to God the Father, because of what Jesus did. And then the last one is Jesus says, I am the vine. In John 15, 1, I am the vine and my Father is the vine dresser. Well, actually, he says, I am the true vine, meaning there's a lot of false vines out there. There's a lot of things that promise to give you life, but only Jesus, the true vine, gives you life as we're connected to him and we abide in him. But Jesus says here, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. Just like bread is a main staple of life, and man can live a long time with like bread and water, we need Jesus, the bread of life, to give us eternal life. In verse 27, he says, he is the food which endures to everlasting life. Verse 32, he is the true bread from heaven. Bread is also a metaphor for God's word. Jesus would say, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I mean, yeah, we need to live by bread, physical bread, to eat in the physical sense, but spiritually, we need the bread, the word of God, on a daily basis. I love what Job said. Job 23, 12, I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. And Jeremiah said almost the same thing. Jeremiah 15, 16, your words were found and I ate them, and your word to me was the joy and rejoicing of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. I pray everybody here loves the word of God. Because as I've said, the word of God is called the word of God for a reason. The Bible is called the Word of God because God has a word for you and a word for me every time we open it. As we talked about a couple weeks ago, we don't read the Bible to learn about God. We read the Bible to know God. You're reading a love letter from the Father to you and from Jesus. So when we read the Bible, it's a great thing. And we need to feed him on him. He didn't say, I am the bread of eternal life, though he is. He says, but I am the bread of life. He's talking about a daily sustenance that we need to gather from him. Basically, what he's saying is, I am essential. I am essential to everything for you. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. I can't help thinking of Matthew 5:6, where Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. You want satisfaction? Follow God and just live a righteous life, doing the right thing. And what he's saying is, he will satisfy our spiritual hunger and thirst to be made righteous in the sight of God. Everybody wants to do better, but we really can't on our own. But when we know the Lord and we start following him, man, you are satisfied. I saw this verse a few weeks ago, or a week ago. It kind of really ministered to me. It says, cast your burden on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never permit the righteous to be shaken. He will sustain you. The bread, if you will, gives you sustenance. It means to strengthen. It means to uphold. But the bread of life does so much more. He enriches our life. Think of all the different kinds of bread. Well, you got wheat bread, you got sourdough, you got white bread. I don't know who eats white bread anymore, but squaw bread. You have all these different types of bread. But then you have these different styles of bread. You have sandwiches, you have pizza dough, you have tortillas, you have, let me see what else you have. You have biscuits, you have croissants. That's what I was thinking. Bagels is what I was thinking. You have muffins. I mean, there's so many different types of food. But then here's another thing, all the things you can add to bread. You know what you can put in a sandwich? A lot. There's all kinds of cool stuff. And you can put on a pizza, and you can put in a burrito, and it's kind of like Jesus is saying, he adds to life, you know? And my wife has this bread machine, and whenever she makes it, I'm just like, I get a whiff, I'm like, you know, I'm almost like in a trance, like, you know? And I'm like, I gotta have a piece. And then I want to put butter on it. If I really want to go big, I'll put honey on it. And I couldn't help but think of this song we used to sing years ago, Jesus, your name is like honey on my lips. Your spirit like water to my soul. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Jesus, I love you. Jesus is everything we need and so much more. And he enriches our life. He is such a blessing. And that's what he's trying to tell him. Hey, I am the bread of life. Don't labor for all this stuff that perishes. You need me. I'm what you need. You've been searching for me your whole life, but you don't realize it. I love how the Bible says in Ecclesiastes 3 that he has put eternity in our hearts. To every human being, he's put eternity in our hearts. And then verse 37, it says, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will by no means cast out. I looked at that, and that's a good balance between election and free will. Election is a term that people use thinking that God calls you and you got nothing to do with it. Free will is man's responsibility that you need to seek the Lord. Well, they kind of merge together even in this verse. All that the Father gives me will come to me. But you need to come. And the one who comes to me, I will by no ways cast out. I just love that. Verse 38 and 40, it really talks about God's will is the salvation of all men. You know, throughout those verses. God's not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance in 2 Peter 3:9. 1 Timothy 2:4, God our Savior desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. And as we finish up here, let me just read a couple promises that the bread of life wants to give us. In verse 35, he who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. That's verse 35. Verse 37, the one that comes to me, I will by no means cast out. In other words, he will not say no to you when you call out to him. Verse 39, of all that the Father has given me, I should lose nothing. You heard the expression, once saved, always saved? If you truly are saved, if you truly give your heart to Christ, you are not going to fall away permanently. What I mean by that is you may fall away, you may backslide, but you know what? You're going to be so stinking miserable. You're going to turn back and you're going to come back to the Lord. That's how you know that you're in God's camp. You know, he's not going to lose you. Verse 40, everyone who believes on the Son has everlasting life. Everyone. Isn't that a great promise? Whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And verse 40, he shall raise him up on the last day. And that's what we were talking about. About a moment ago in John 11:25. But Jesus is basically trying to get their eyes off of their fleshly desires and put them on him who is the one that should be their desire. David, the man after God's own heart, said this, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. And David is just saying, that is my one desire, that I would spend time with the Lord and I would behold his beauty as he just thinks on the Lord and prays and reads his Bible or whatever. Well, he had the Old Testament, but still reading about God, calling upon God, but then inquiring of God, like taking all of his concerns. The Bible says, cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you. And that's what Jesus was doing, is, hey, I am the bread of life. I'm not this physical bread. I am everything you need. And so as we transition to communion here, I couldn't help but think, you know, there's another metaphor, if you will, for bread, and that's the body of Jesus. You know, Jesus said this, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. This is when Jesus was in the upper room, and he was just hours away from being arrested and to go to the cross for us. And he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. So the bread and the wine are is symbolic of the body and the blood, you know, or the juice, you know. And that's what Jesus also saying, I am the bread of life. My body was broken for you. You need to come to me. We're going to have the worship team come up here and lead us in a communion song. And if anybody didn't get a communion element, raise your hand and somebody will hand one to them. Did everybody get one? Okay, one in the back there?
One in the back.
Or one right there? Raise hands. If somebody could get some communion elements to them. And they're going to do a communion song. And then we're going to have Jeff and his lovely bride, Mandy, come up and they're going to pray with us. But here's something to think about. Jesus tells us that we should examine our hearts. Actually, Paul tells us to that, but he's talking about speaking for the Lord. He talks about it in 1 Corinthians 11, that we should examine our hearts. You know, that we shouldn't take communion in an unworthy manner. That means there should be no unconfessed sin in our lives. We shouldn't come with just a frivolous attitude, like a cavalier attitude, like, oh, this is just something we do, no big deal. No, when we take communion, we are to think about what he did. And that thinking about what he did should cause us to say, I want to live for him. Is there something in my life that I need to get right with the Lord? Is there something I'm doing that is not pleasing to him? Is there a compromise? Is there an actual sin? Is there a doubtful area that I know the Lord's not happy about this, but I'm allowing it to happen? God wants us to confess that before we take communion. But also, it also talks about how you only take communion if you are a believer, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. And obviously that begs the question, is everybody here a follower of Jesus Christ? I pray and hope everybody is, but I don't know every single person here. But as I said earlier, God knows and he knows your heart. So I'm going to have you guys bow for a word of prayer. And I'm going to give an opportunity for anybody who doesn't know Christ to receive Christ. And then we're going to go into the song. I'll actually make one more comment. But let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Lord, the Bible also says, examine yourself in, I believe it's 2 Corinthians 13, to see if you're in the faith. There are many that think they're in the faith, but they're not in the faith. And my prayer is, has everyone here confessed their sins to Christ, asked him to be their Lord and Savior, and are they following him? And if that's not, then maybe you've never been born again. You've never truly given your heart to Jesus Christ. Well, this could be your moment. God wants you to have the gift of eternal life. The Bible says whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. All we need to do is call upon him, ask for his forgiveness, invite him into our heart to be our Lord and Savior. If that speaks of anybody here that does not know Christ but wants to have their sin forgiven, wants to follow Jesus, wants to have the hope of heaven, if that's you, just raise your hand right now. I'd like to pray for you. Anybody here wants to give their life to Jesus, have the hope of going to heaven or have their sin forgiven? Okay, I don't see anybody raising their hand. That's fine. If everyone here is a believer, praise the Lord. If you're not, God's still talking to you and he's going to get a hold of you in his timing. But right now, as the worship team plays this song, we need to ask ourselves, we need to take inventory of our life. As I said earlier, is there an area that God is speaking to me on? if there is, get it right. Or just worship in your heart. Lord, thank you for going to the cross. Lord, thank you for allowing your body to be beaten. Thank you, Jesus, for rising again from the dead. And just worship him. So we're going to have a time of worship. And then we're going to have my friends come up here, and they're going to pray over the elements.
Of communion is to remember the sacrifice that Jesus made for us all. Jesus suffered on the cross and died for our sins because he loved us so much. I was reading an article, and I like how this gentleman put his name, Dr. Douglas Gruthus. He said that God became man, Jesus, and he sacrificed his all for all he came to save. He sacrificed his all for all he came to save. When it was time for Passover, and they got together for celebration, Jesus and the 12 disciples gathered for supper. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:24, he says, "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you now for the gift of your Son, Jesus, Lord, who came to earth as a man to suffer and die, sacrificing all his love or his life for our sins. And as we partake now, Lord, I just pray that we would never forget the sacrifice that your Son, Jesus, made for us. Amen. Let's partake together.
Corinthians 11:25. "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" Let's pray. And Lord Jesus, in the same way with this cup, it's representing your blood that you shed for us. And Father, I'm reminded that you shed your blood for not only the sin that I'm going to commit today and tomorrow, but all my past, present, and future. Father, thank you so much that you loved us so much, that you wanted to set us free from the bondage of sin. Father, thank you that you went to the cross. Father, thank you that you shed your blood for our sin. We remember you.
Risen and exalted.
Finish up. I'm going to be praying a prayer out of Philippians. I really like this prayer because it talks about love, about that our love would grow in knowledge and all discernment. See, when we become Christians, we don't just boom, all of a sudden we're loving. We need to grow in knowledge and discernment. Kind of like a parent thinks it's loving to give their kids everything, and then they learn a few things. They go, this is not a good idea. This is not love, you know? God wants to teach us how to love. And the more that we know Jesus, the more we're in his word and in fellowship and seeking his face, he's going to make us those loving vessels. And what he wants us to do is he wants to show his love through us to all the different people that God brings us in contact with. So I'm going to pray this prayer and just receive it. Just take it for yourself, but you can look at it later. It's Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11. And this I pray, that your love may abound or grow still more and more in knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and the praise of God. Amen. Hey, real quickly, if you need some prayer, we're going to have a few folks over there that will pray with you. And just a kind of a follow-up on that announcement about Camp Allendale. What happens, we have this date set, and all of a sudden this big old snow came in, and then I was talking to them, and like, I don't know, there might be tons of snow on the ground, but I can take a few contractors if they still want to come that can work inside. Now it's the snow's open up a little bit, but he says no one's come up there to help them since we did in November. So whoever wants to go on that list, there's a list for the 20th of this month, but then the 20th of next month, we're all going to go, whoever can go. But if a few of you still want to go on this other date, that's fine too. So the lists are out there. So guys, God bless you. Have a great day and have some great fellowship. There's coffee and snacks and all kinds of stuff. So just enjoy.
Thank you.